This is the iPhone 11 Pro, and these are the most powerful and most advanced iPhones that we have ever built in a stunning new design.
We get it, Tim. You want to sell us new phones. But what about that amazing phone that you announced 12 months ago on that same stage?
This is iPhone XS.
Wasn't that the best phone ever? And seeing new iPhones come out every year and the prices go up and up and up, I started asking myself, is the newest iPhone like really the best one out there? I'm gonna look at older iPhones, even going back as far as 6 years, to see if you can still get the best of Apple experiences and put to the test if the newest iPhone really is the best iPhone. So we're gonna get to which iPhone is actually the best, and I think you'll be surprised, but I do wanna thank this video's sponsor, Clean My Mac X. We'll talk about them later on in the video. So when a new iPhone comes out, the phones that came out last year or year before tended to slow down. It was something people mentioned in whispers. They didn't wanna update to the latest version of iOS because they were worried it was gonna slow their phone down. For years, it sounded ridiculous, until it wasn't.
Apple is apologizing after admitting a software update deliberately slowed some older iPhones. The tech giant says the update is intended to prevent sudden shutdowns in the iPhone 6.
So this is kind of what people have started calling Apple's planned obsolescence, where with every software update, older phones get slower and slower as you go further back in generations. And I guess logically that would make sense. The power in those phones gets less and less compared to what's new. Batteries tend to degrade. The headroom that those phones had with speed and performance has gotten lower and lower till eventually it's bumping up against everything that operating system can do. That made sense, but also seemed really coincidental. So if you don't know, Apple has had multiple class action lawsuits brought against them for this very thing, and Apple has had to pay millions of dollars for each one. So those filing the lawsuits were claiming that Apple purposely slowed down the phones just as a sales tactic to get you to buy a whole brand new iPhone. So Apple's side of the story, they were claiming that when their phone's battery performance dropped below 80%, so battery health, it was affecting the performance of their phones, and it wasn't meeting sort of what Apple's minimal standards for effectiveness of their phones. To get the Apple experience, they couldn't deliver it with batteries that had dipped that far, so Apple was slowing them down to slow down the battery degradation. That was the reason behind it. And according to Apple, it was for the betterment of their consumers. So I'm gonna get into, you know, my opinion on it, whether or not I think that's true later in the video. But for now, I wanna get real world tests on some of Apple's older phones that are above that 80% threshold of battery, so they haven't gotten sort of that throttling, that can still run iOS 14 and see how they stack up against Apple's latest, you know, the iPhone 12. And I think the best place to start is with the camera. Typically, I really like, and you can probably tell, blind camera tests for cameras that are relatively in close quality to one another. But this might be one of the easiest blind camera tests that I've ever done on this channel. Say, having said that, can you tell which one is the iPhone 12? Look at things like sharpness, highlight preservation, color temperature, how it treats shadows. You can see it gets better with each subsequent iPhone released, and that's very clear from these examples. Probably you could very easily pick out which one was the iPhone 12, but how'd you do with the others? Were you able to tell which one was better among the not iPhone 12 options? So very clearly, changes have been made to Apple's camera software and hardware and image. Something that's been with Apple since the iPhone 6S is 4K video recording. I think granted the sharpness of that video is definitely going to vary depending on which phone you're using, but you can still enjoy features like that while running the latest iOS on a 6-year-old phone. That is not something that I think other phone manufacturers can say. And if you're interested, we actually did a very similar video for the Pixel side as well, comparing from the Pixel 2 all the way up to the Pixel 5 with some, I think, surprising results. If you wanna check out that video, we'll link to it down below. So clearly and obviously, the iPhone 12's camera quality like stomps those other models into the dirt in every single way. And I think I was expecting that, and probably I'm guessing you were too. Apple's camera quality is pretty linear. Each new phone that comes out, its camera is better than the last one in most ways. So from a camera standpoint, if you want to have the best camera, that Apple has to offer. Still best bet, and you have the means to do it, is pick up the newest iPhone. Looking at these iPhone 10 photos, they're a lot closer to the iPhone 12's quality than I remembered in my head. The HDR doesn't always hold up as well, in all fairness, but I was still pretty pleasantly surprised at how well the iPhone 10 has held up. So I've said it before, I'm just gonna say it again if you're keeping up. All these phones can run iOS 14, so that means they are getting the latest security updates. Now, if you're doing like just normal phone things, things like texting, making calls, general scrolling around the phone, third-party apps, stuff, you're not gonna notice a huge difference between any of these phones. I think that shows the processing power of Apple's own silicon. You start to see real performance issues in things like playing games, taking pictures. And as expected, just like camera quality, there's a direct correlation of the performance to its age. Games load much slower on the older phones, especially when I play games that are more graphic intensive. The performance, though, did not feel all that different between the iPhone 12 and the iPhone 10, but I did see a significant performance drop on like the 6S Plus, not only when starting games, but there's also an occasional frame rate drop as well. So going back to the camera, at least the performance of the camera, not the actual image, I did notice something that I don't remember being a problem when I owned the 6S Plus. The shutter lag on the 6S Plus is really bad. Maybe it got worse on iOS updates as they went along, but like, I mean really bad. Like the photo that I thought I was snapping when I hit the shutter button was definitely not the moment that the 6S ended up taking. On the iPhone 10, that's not an issue. It seems just as fast as the iPhone 12 on the shutter side, which obviously doesn't have any shutter lag at all. But again, this isn't just the software's fault here. It's mainly just older, outdated hardware that can't keep up with the software. So, and I think that's a point that I want to come back to. I think this is what a lot of people will point out as part of Apple's planned obsolescence. They make their software take these huge jumps between operating systems, allegedly on purpose, so the hardware can't keep up. That's a sales tactic, right? If you see that your phone can't keep up with the software you have, you think your phone is outdated, presumably you will go buy a new one. If Apple has their way, you'll buy a new Apple phone. Well, we've heard that argument, right? We've heard that for years. If that were true, why would Apple still support the 6S Plus, a device that again is 6 years old at this point? So computers are like obviously expensive, right? They're not something that we're replacing every day or every month. So I've got right here a MacBook Air from 2015, which makes it, by my keen math brain, 6 years old. And if you've got a computer that is unoptimized, like this one, riddled with spyware, malware, and there's actually software you can run to make your older system seem and act newer. You've probably heard of it. We've talked about it here on the channel for years. It is called Clean My Mac X. So trying to do anything on this machine as is stupidly slow and doesn't have to be. So Clean My Mac X chases the junk in all corners of macOS. So it's gonna do things like clean uneven files, like outdated cache, broken downloads, logs, useless localizations. It's also going to remove tons of clutter that you may not know are there, freeing up storage. So it boils down to making sure you can trust your Mac, and Clean My Mac X is another tool to make sure that you can do that. They also have a new challenge out. It's hashtag MacSOS challenge to kind of show you things that you can do to speed up your old computer. If you want to learn more about Clean My Mac X, and I think you should, either go to their website or just click the link down below. People like to criticize Apple for being profit-driven. And I always harken back to, sure, they are, they're a publicly traded company. That's literally Tim Cook's job, is to make profit. But for this argument, I don't see any profit-centric reason for them to support a phone that is 6 years old. Those phones are worth almost nothing to buy used. It's worth almost nothing to Apple to have people keep using those phones, but yet they're still supporting them. And I think the same thing is going for the iPhone batteries. They use lithium-ion batteries like every other phone. They degrade over time. It's the physics, it's the chemistry of sort of the lithium ion that's in there. Now, obviously there are things you can do to mitigate degradation of the battery, but ultimately, and again, like people, you can't stop it from aging. And I think this is where we start to see why Apple lost these class action lawsuits, because Apple knew about battery degradation and exactly how it impacted performance of their phones, and they didn't say anything about it publicly. In their reports, mainly with the iPhone 6S, battery percentage, when like low, maybe 10, 20%, would suddenly drop off to like nothing. So you look at your phone, it had 18% battery life left, and then it would suddenly just go to zero and shut off. And that is a problem. And imagine a scenario I imagine a lot of people found themselves in. Side of the road, car's broken down, middle of nowhere-ish. Pull out your phone to call for help. You know, I got 18%, I got enough to make a phone call. And suddenly your phone just goes dead. You're gonna be in trouble if you don't have a cord with you. And that is a really big reliability and safety issue with the phone, and one Apple was clearly not comfortable with. So they consciously chose, behind closed doors, to scale phone's performance down so the phone wouldn't suddenly shut off. It wouldn't leave people, you know, stranded, so to speak. Essentially choosing, at least in Apple's minds, the lesser of the two evils. They're taking the lower performance for a phone that's still going to function. Now, for me, I can understand the business rationale, and I think it's probably a fair compromise considering the phones are older. But I think the issue people had, and me included, was Apple didn't tell people that. They didn't say it. And I think that lack of transparency was ultimately the reason that Apple lost those lawsuits. Or at the very least, it could have given users the choice. Which way do you want to go? A choose your own adventure. Pick your path, know your consequences. And as a result of the first lawsuit, Apple, if you remember, offered battery replacements for older iPhones. Actually, they're still doing now. That way you can have a healthier battery in an older phone, and its performance only be limited by the internal hardware as opposed to the software. So all of that still doesn't scream planned obsolescence, at least to me. While the experience might have been slower on older phones, you could still like use those phones. In the event you're stranded, again on that side of the road analogy, you would still have a phone that works. It might be slower than the newer, faster one, but you still have a phone that functions. I would prefer that than one that could just die on a moment's notice. But all of these kind of like planned obsolescence lawsuits keep coming, and they eventually could, I think, have some pretty big consequences for consumers. So I'm gonna editorialize a bit. I think these lawsuits in the short term are generally pretty good for consumers. It lets companies, Apple included, know that there are sort of issues and consequences that can happen for not being transparent. I think ultimately that was Apple's bigger issue. They didn't disclose what they were doing, and again, they didn't give users choice. But the more of these class action lawsuits that happen, I think an unintended consequence is going to be Apple's going to stop officially supporting older devices. So perhaps people will look to buy newer iPhones, phones that have been out for 1 to 2 years. That'll drive that price up. It's simple economics, supply and demand. Where people looking to buy those phones, the prices are going to continue to skyrocket. So the folks who had limited budgets that wanted a 3 or 4 year old iPhone presumably won't be able to buy one, or would not want to buy one because it can't run the latest software from Apple. I don't know, economics brain kind of working here, but at least it does seem like unintended consequence that perhaps could end up not helping consumers while trying to help consumers. So to the question I asked at the beginning, do you have to buy the newest phone to get the Apple experience? I was actually surprised. The answer is very clearly no. I think the 3 year old iPhone X is probably the best combination of value to, like, let's just call it Appleness. You're still getting the cutting edge tech like you have in Face ID, albeit for first generation. You're still getting HDR, though clearly it's not as good as what's out right now. You're getting a phone that in-app performance still feels close to as quick as what's out. There's no shutter lag, video is still really good. You get a phone that still looks like a modern iPhone, but now for, depending on where you go, $300, $350, you're getting still, you know, quote, the best of Apple without having to shell out $8,000, $9,000 to get the latest shiny thing. I think there's a point to that, and me especially, you feed into the machine of having to buy the newest, while what came out a few years ago is still equally good. Just because something comes out that's better doesn't make what came before it bad. And that's a perspective that I still struggle with in my own head as I sort of feed into that consumer machine of always wanting to get the latest and greatest. And if you look to get that iPhone X, I think you should know that you're getting a phone that's 3 years old. So you're halfway to that 6 year point we talked about with the iPhone 6S. You presumably won't get the same shelf life of buying a new phone, but if you're cool with that, keeping a phone for 1, 2, or even as far as the 3 years, you are still going to get the best of Apple.